Detectives, welcome to Unlocked, the official podcast for all things Nancy Drew by Her Interactive. I'm your host, Tammy Tuckey, and this week we welcome voiceover artist Ben Lawrence to the show. Welcome, Ben.
Hello, Tammy.
It's great to have you on. You know, we've been working to get this interview together, and finally we get to talk, so I'm excited.
Yeah, me too. Thanks for having me on.
And how did you first get into the voiceover industry?
Well, I have a degree in theater from the University of Washington, and so I basically spent my early 20s just trying to do anything and everything. I never said no. And I found myself doing a bunch of theater at a fringe theater in Seattle called Annex Theater, and there I met a lot of people. I met a lot of great actors who I'm still pretty good friends with today. It kind of came out in terms of like who I knew and who would recommend me for things. And a friend of mine had actually done a couple of voices for the Nancy Drew series and said, I've given your name to one of the directors and she might be calling you. And so that's kind of how it got started. I didn't call them to say, hey, I want to be a voice in your video game. It was basically just somebody I knew said, hey, I think you have a great voice. I've given your name, so she'll be calling you. The thing about Seattle is if you want to work, there's no loss for opportunities to do art in Seattle. But if you want to get paid for it, then the opportunities are very limited, because Seattle is one of those places where you create and you generate your weird little art, and then if you want to make a living as an actor, then the opportunities here are very limited. You have to go to Chicago or Los Angeles or New York. However, that has begun to change because we have Microsoft in town and we have Amazon in town. And so those opportunities for voiceover artists specifically are actually starting to build up. I just read an article in the paper today about how the voice of GLaDOS is doing a play down in Olympia. The voice in the game Portal, I think, because Valve is over in Bellevue. So, it's funny because I meet some people and I'm like, oh, yeah, you sound kind of familiar. And then they're like, oh, yeah, well, I'm this major character that you know in this video game. And so, yeah, but as far as people in Seattle help each other out, you have to, because that's how you get work in this town. I actually just looked up one of the emails that I was sent. This is back in 2004, so I had to go back pretty far. But yeah, I was sent an email, and I was sent a number of different sides, and what the direct and Jim Archer from The Secret of the Old Clock was one of them, and the director said, you know, I'm looking for great voices, but I'm also just looking for a performance. And I believe that was, if I remember correctly, and again, it's been 13 years, the audition where I went in for Jim Archer was my third audition with Her Interactive. And it was because I was still very young and green at this point, and so I had no idea basically what I was doing. I want to say that the entire process took, if it took more than an hour, then it did not take 2 hours. I want to say it was between an hour and 2 hours. A very quick process, actually. It was at a recording studio on the waterfront here in Seattle, and it was my very first time doing something like this. If I'm honest, it was the first time I'd ever been voice acting professionally, and I had no idea what I was doing. And I mean, I was like, I had theatrical training, so I knew how to follow directions, right? But I think the problem was my nerves probably got the best of me. And judging from what you say, it probably kind of fit with the character. But I remember being in such a haze that, because it was in the morning, you know, it was like I probably was called at like 9 or 10 o'clock in the morning, and so I hadn't had maybe the opportunity to get warmed up properly during the day. So, you know, you walk in and there's a booth and a soundproof booth, and there's a window into the engineering section of the recording studio, and you have your headphones and your microphone and your music stand, and they just take you through the lines one by one, and you read them different ways and give the director, you know, different options for how the lines should be read. And along the way, if you read something wrong, or if you probably stumble on a word or mispronounce something, then they'll let you through that. But I think the whole process, yeah, probably took less than 2 hours.
How did they finally agree upon a voice, a particular voice for this character? Did they just say one of the voices that you auditioned with sounded great, you know, tweak it up a little bit, you know, bring it down a little bit? How did that work?
I think because I did audition with that character, and so I kind of had a primer on what they wanted for that character. So going into the recording booth, it wasn't so much I was starting fresh. I did kind of have an idea of what they wanted, and but as far as like what kind of, you know, how they were able to draw that out, I don't think there wasn't a lot of characterization, to be honest. I think they probably just identified this voice as that character, and so just they directed me in terms of probably emotion and not so much cartoon characterization, because I did finally see the clip from the video game, and yeah, I'm watching it going, yeah, you know, that kind of sounds like me, that kind of sounds how I talk. Probably back then when I was super nervous standing inside of a recording booth with a bunch of strangers.
So finally the game is completed. Did you get to play it yourself or at least hear yourself in the game?
No, I didn't actually. Because I think the game came out maybe about a year after I had recorded my part. I still had that that sense of, oh, I did everything wrong. When I walked out of the studio, I received the game in the mail, and I never played it because a couple of reasons. One, I don't have a PC, and it was a PC only game. And two, I was sure that I screwed it up so much that they redid my voice, and I just had that in my head. I just had that sort of paranoia that I, it turns out, because that's my biggest fear, right? As an actor, when you get a part or you do a role, your biggest fear is not like going up on stage and forgetting your lines. Your biggest fear is, what if they regret casting me? And so I had that in my head. And so this was like 2005, I think, when the game came out. And I basically, they sent me a copy, and I gave it to my nephews. I don't know if they ever played it. But you sent me a clip of it that's online. And so yesterday was the first time I had ever seen that clip. And I will say that I think I have the luxury of time and distance. I was kind of charmed by it. And, you know, maybe I do want to go back and play this game. And I do want to know, I don't know if it's answered in the game, but I do want to know who was on that phone call.
So have you been doing more voiceovers for different games as of late? And do you even play those games?
No, I don't. Voiceover is not really something that I pursue these days. I did have a modicum of success with films and TV, like right out of college. And then I fell into this fringe theater crowd here in Seattle and stuck with them. So I've been basically doing theater. I did theater all throughout my 20s and 30s, like on stage stuff. And then now I'm more, I, I like creating things, and so I don't spend so much time in rehearsals anymore. I do film and video, and so like write and direct and produce. So that's kind of where I'm at right now. But yeah, as far as voiceover work is concerned, yeah, it's been a long time. It's a long time. You know, we have here in Seattle, we have a lot of big game companies, and I'd like to think that I've learned a lot in the last number of years since I first did a video game. I don't think that I have a very, like, I can't modulate or make funny voices. Like, I know I have certain friends who have worked on the Nancy Drew series who can just change it up at will and do any kind of voice you want. That's not really a talent that I think I have. Yeah, I did have one experience. I remember it was about 5 or 6 years ago. There's a game company here in Seattle, and they produce mostly board games, but a lot of board games that integrate multimedia aspects. Like, I think at the time it was like DVDs come with the board game, but now it's probably like go to this website and stream the videos you need to watch. And they were developing a new game aimed at children. And so what I was part of the playtesting aspect of this game development. And so at the business where they develop the games, there's probably a proper word for it. It's just not coming to me. But it was like a recording booth, right? There was a big area where the kids played with certain aspects, and there was a TV in the room where that the child interacted with. And I was on the other side of the one-way glass with the director and a couple of the producers, and there was a camera, like, pointing down on to the flat table next to me, and I had a puppet on my hand, and the puppet interacted with the child. And so I had to improv these scenes with a kid to see, like, kind of figure out how the game goes and how the flow of the game should go. And that was actually, I will be honest, that was one of the hardest things that I've had to do, because I'm not a trained improviser. And a lot of people are like, oh, improvisation, you just make stuff up. No, you have to work at that. And I've never taken any improv classes or anything like that. And so trying to do that, as well as interacting with and trying to figure out how a child's mind works, that was super difficult. And I don't know if this game was ever released, but if it was, I hope that my involvement helped them some. It's definitely a unique skill set, and you have to convey a lot through just your voice. Whereas, you know, there's different levels of acting, right? You know, there's theatrical acting where you're very big because you want the back of the house to see you, and then there's television film acting, which can be very, very small and very subtile motions. I mean, I did a film recently where the director asked me to like convey some sort of emotion, but just through my eyes, you know, and so I would just make these subtle adjustments to what I was doing. And then he would come up to me and he would say, I think I led you too far in that direction. Let's pull it back a bit. And it's so interesting how small things can be. And I think with video game voiceover, it's like the subtleness might not be as small, but the performance is maybe small is not the right word, but it's more exact, I think. You have to convey so much through just an inflection and you know, maybe like raising your voice at some point, whereas, you know, not doing it, and that just tells the game player so much.
Well, I can't thank you enough for being on the show. And my last question that I ask every guest on the show is, if you could describe your experience working with Her Interactive and being a part of the Nancy Drew universe using one word, what would that be?
I would say unique for me, because that was the only time I've ever done something like this. I'm tickled that it has had this life after all these years. So often as a performer, when you do multimedia stuff, it just kind of like disappears into the void. So I'm really, really happy that the one time I did a Nancy Drew game, that it has persisted this long, and I'm able to talk to you now 13 years later.